Exploring physically interactive probation experience design, with the purpose of conducting a case study, assessing design decisions with the goal of increasing awareness of and participation with the MAD Founders nonprofit. So over the past 2 years, I've cultivated an interest in new projects at the crossroads of interactive products and data visualization. My interest in tangible interfaces that allow users to interact with information and data in new ways inspired this master's project. I want to find out how to effectively design a user experience in the space of physically interactive information visualizations. However, knowing I'll spend a year working on the project, I want to make sure it has some type of purpose beyond filling my master's thesis requirement. So I decided to add the constraint of finding a nonprofit that's doing valuable work in the city for whom I would build the project for. So the two goals within this project didn't initially align, and that had to be reconciled. Engaging in a project exploring the design of physically interactive information visualizations may not mean building the most helpful product for whichever nonprofit I'm working with. So I decided that the service goal had to exist within the research goal. So my core research question was, what elements contribute to effective design of physical interactive information experiences with respect to the inspired action of helping a local nonprofit? So through the guidance of my advisor, I approached this project using frameworks developed in the field of experience design. These methods highlight how to obtain user insights and translate them into interactive environments that tell stories in fun and profound ways. The ultimate outcome is to architect the emotional state of the users and inspire positive action. So at this point, I had to find a nonprofit stakeholder to move forward with the research phase of the project. Over the summer, I networked with several grassroots movements, and was eventually put in touch with the MAD Housers. Founded in 1987, their mission is harm reduction for Atlanta's most vulnerable homeless. They do this by building $500 shelters and giving them away at no cost to the clients. I appreciated their focus on action rather than talk. Recently, the MAD Housers announced expansion of their mission statement to connecting clients with services beyond their shelters. While personal shelters are a major step to recovery for many of their clients, access to additional services like nurses and social workers are needed for more serious cases. So my research goal was amended to determining design elements for an information experience that promoted broader participation with the MAD Housers from individuals with skills outside of shelter construction. So citizens with valuable skills were my target users. My initial research phase would be immersive and contextual ethnography. Here I would participate in the various events held by the MAD Housers and understand more about their work, process, motivation, and challenges. This would help me understand the MAD Housers, generate information about for my experience, craft my interview questions, build rapport, and make contacts for the secondary research phase. The secondary phase was focused on conducting user interviews with past volunteers and target users. The core goal to distill the idea of what motivates me to get involved. I also interviewed MAD Housers' clients to get information about their experiences before and after contact with the nonprofit. So, immersive and contextual research involved me participating in their regularly scheduled monthly events where they build and deploy components of their shelters. They have a network of regulars who show up, and they are supplemented by outside organizations looking to volunteer, whom the MAD Housers facilitate and oversee. Volunteers learn valuable construction skills, as well as information about the homeless in the city, often meeting clients to help with their shelter needs. For the secondary research phase, I recorded interviews with 5 past volunteers, 6 target users with valuable skills, the organization president, and 4 clients. Interviews with past volunteers aim to distill volunteer motivation and engage their experience. Speaking with clients, I gathered like-in-time stories before and after MAD Housers intervention. Interviewing the president revealed more about the updated mission and organizational needs and difficulties, and interviews with target users distilled motivations for why they would volunteer, have volunteered in the past, or any other difficulties that they might have had. To synthesize my research, I opted to organize findings into two main sections. Motivation findings concern quotes, contain quotes concerning why people would choose to get involved in an organization like the Madhousers. The other section contained quotes about the Madhousers' operations in general. These would further inform my design and could be included in the experience story. So some key anecdotal findings in the Madhousers category include the following. Clients felt their shelter and camps were invaluable staples of stability and safety for them, even if there was a lot of work involved in their maintenance. Volunteers highlighted the traditional building experience as a time-efficient but high-impact way to give back. It was also a hands-on learning experience. Interviews with the president, Tracy Woodard, I learned of their difficulties coordinating city authority figures, their resource channels, and about their expanding mission to involve more public health professionals. So there are four key finding clusters within the motivation category. First, users are motivated because they feel they are no different from the homeless or extreme empathy. Users felt it could happen to anyone, or it has happened to them, or someone close to them. Secondly, users' roles influence how frequently and whom with they volunteer. Users often had careers or previous volunteer activities that aligned with their desires to volunteer now. Next, users are deeply affected by the state of their environment, national and local. Sentiments describing holes in the system and the safety net, as well as horror stories about what they have seen in their environment, were very potent motivators. So lastly, the target users were influenced by a desire for genuine human connection. There was an underlying belief that talking to people face-to-face humanized them. Users wanted to connect to something bigger than themselves without the presence of invisible walls. So prior to ideating on my design, I made an adjustment to my target user. Initially, I was designing for individuals with valuable skills like nurses and social workers. However, after interviewing several, I realized that this population already had a predisposition to public service. So designing something to promote further involvement in public service in that population would not be super effective. Instead, I expanded my target group to professionals who may have alternative valuable skills, such as resume building, budget creation, first aid, or people who are just good listeners. So based on the findings from both research and secondary research, I made four information experience design decisions. First was to include a mirror in the experience. This was to inspire users to be self-aware, at least reflective upon themselves when listening to stories of the Madhousers. It is known that people are more aware or self-aware in the presence of the mirror, and so to maximize the empathetic effect, I wanted to emphasize the mirror, particularly during audio quotes that mention how the homeless were no different from that user. The second design decision was with the final call to action. I wanted to reference how a variety of professionals could contribute regardless of the skills that they currently have. Title, What is Your Superpower? It asks individuals what their skill set they had currently was. The Madhousers are looking to expand services offered to their clients beyond the offering of the huts. So this will require involvement of these skills, the people with skills outside of their typical marketing function. The next design element was to include a map of the city with a GIS visualization of where the densest homeless populations were. If people are influenced by their environments, showing where the homeless are in the cities and neighborhoods would inspire introspection. Second Story used a similar design method to create empathy among employees within their office space. The last design element was to include audio stories from clients of the Madhousers. They should communicate the client's journey and how the Madhousers have helped them. This feature aims to reduce the barrier between users and clients. The story would flow like a conversation, allowing users to connect with clients on a deeper level. So the base, next I mentioned prototyping. So the base of the prototyping is an acrylic mirror. I did a GIS design with the homeless data in Photoshop and rare engraving on the back of the acrylic mirror. Using Arduino, I was able to create capacitive touch sensors as a means to provide users with a means to manipulate the user interface. I included a NeoPixel rope in order to backlight the mirror so the engraving would be, the engraving of the visual info disk would be highly visible. The backlight would only trigger when users were within a certain distance. Finally, I included an MP3 player shield on the microcontroller. This would allow the touch sensors to trigger specific audio audio stories that are spliced together from client and volunteer interviews. So establish control conditions. So typically, a lot of user tests that I've seen didn't require deliberate controls, because in most cases, the control was achieving the task without that set product. However, the desired task that I was trying to do had no previous precedent, because the research goal was to explore design in the space of physical information experiences. So my control medium was going to be an interactive pricing on an iPad. Specifically for the mirror design element, the control would be quotes about reasons why people got involved with the Mad Project, allowing me to test my mirror design element in conjunction with audio from individuals who say homeless are just like themselves. The control for the What's Your Superpower design element was just a text-based version along the same lines of the What's Your Superpower text. And I realized afterwards that this was really not a great control. It's really only assessed the value of my voice within the design. The control for the client audio stories or quotes and photos from that project's clients, I felt that this control was also not the best, since the content was the crux of that design element, and it was very similar between the mirror and the control. However, the mirror having audio was a more conversational design element. So lastly, the control for the map would be a simple text-based feature explaining how many and where the homes are in the city without an actual visualization. This would assess the value of the map. So the qualitative test assessed two success metrics for my design, inference and impact. So to do this, I asked participants to interact with my control and or mirror for at least 2 to 3 minutes with me not present. I gave them a brief introduction to the Mad House and explained the experience was intended to tell their story. They can interact as long as they want, as long as they interacted for that minimum time. When finished, they would come get me and I would ask follow-up questions related to their interpretation of the experience. For each design element, I asked the users to tell me what they remembered, what impact it had on them, and to rate impactfulness on a scale from 0 to 10, where 0 meant no impact and 10 meant impact towards immediate action. So there was two things. Oh yeah, so one pilot, 3 tests for the control, and 2 pilot and 3 tests for the mirror. I kind of didn't count the pilots at the end, but I mean, technically it did one. So, from observing the video, participants were very comfortable operating the iPad, interacting very quickly and naturally. The range of length of interaction for the controls between 2 and 5 minutes. However, with the mirror, subjects were noticeably slower to interact and curious with the features. They took time to assess the features, try new things, look at the pattern, or just kind of stand and listen to the audio. Regarding the map specifically, the design imprinted more on users than the information presented in the control. However, the map received a lower average impact rating than the control. This was due to users feeling ambivalent towards the map, having no direct relevance to them. Regarding client, yeah, go ahead.
Let me interrupt, just so I'm clear. I don't think I understand how that mirror is being used.
Yeah, so the mirror is supposed to inspire reflection.
Yeah.
That came from my user finding of they're just like me. I don't see any difference between myself and the homeless. So it's supposed to create kind of a self-awareness when users are listening to folks that specifically say those things.
So are they, it's just kind of there, but it's not like helping them perform with apps? Or
no, it's not.
It's just not.
Yeah, it's just there. Yeah, it's supposed to inspire an emotion.
Okay.
Yeah.
And it has capacitive touch buttons.
Yeah, I mean, it does serve.
Okay.
Are you asking more about what's the interaction paradigm?
Yeah, exactly. I mean, it is the means of the interface, but the reflective aspect of the mirror, like it could just be plastic, but the actual fact that it's reflective is its own design.
Okay, got it.
Yeah. Right. Regarding client stories, these trended well in both the control and the mirror experience. Individuals really connected with the stories and photos. In stories and photos, their retention of information was pretty high for both the control and the mirror. The impact ratings were higher for the mirror due to the longer stories and the conversational atmosphere of the audio. However, presence of pictures were noted as a high point in the control. I suspect the results were pretty similar between the mirror and control for the What's Your Superpower element. To note, individuals felt that any call to action is incomplete without some ability to sign up immediately. Retention in the empathy, so this is the actual mirror element, the specific reflective design element I'm talking about. So retention was actually higher in the control test of information. I believe this was due to the fact that there was much less content, because users in both the control and the mirror test users often cited the same impactful quotes for both the control and the actual test. So impact trended to be the same for both, with only one user citing the self-reflection aspect of the reflection, of the mirror reflection, as very impactful. So the quantitative test was conducted mainly to assess how the experiences would do actually out in the field. To do this, I coordinated with some Centergy building and placed my control in their lobby where there was significant foot traffic of professionals. Over 2 days, for 2 hours during peak foot traffic times, I recorded information from the bushes. Metrics like were number of interaction, length of interaction, and type of interaction. I also intended to record a number of signups for each iteration, so I included small signup slips and a box, so with both the control and the mirror experience. So, as you can see, this study did not yield great results. Most people just simply walked past the mirror, both the control and the mirror experience. My hypothesis is that the time I conducted the study, when people were leaving work, played against this success. However, there were some findings to note. Most people spent longer times interacting with the mirror in terms of both passing by and looking and actually interacting. So whenever there was an interaction with the mirror, there was generally a longer period. There were some really long periods of interaction with the mirror. So continuing forward, I plan to dive deeper into my qualitative data that I've generated and need to conduct more user tests to generate a little bit more robust and reliable data, because I need to figure out what features I need to bolster and what features I need to cull from the mirror. I also want to take some of the insights from my quantitative test to build some more deliberate attractors for the experience. And I need to make these changes because I want to give the mirror to the Met Housers for use in promoting their organization in the future. So lastly, I just want to say, thank you to a bunch of people, thank you to the Met House organization and their clients, thank you to my advisors, the Hunter Spencer, Tom, Carrie Thompson, and Carrie Roos, all my research participants and everybody else, so many people along the way. Thanks. Any questions? Essentially, users had more time to get to know a particular client for the information within that house. And that was an advantage towards the experience. But it didn't necessarily map towards actual real life deployment, where individuals had to actually, it was shorter interactions on the scale of seconds. And in my lab test, they were actually on the scale of minutes. So while the features I designed showed marginal improvement over a typical kiosk in terms of testing, they were pretty much negated by the fact that there weren't that many more people interacting with them in a regular setting. So that was something that I had to address. Well, that I really have to address, I think, from its iteration.
Yeah, and I think, we have lots of discussions about the study design and how we could actually test this. And there's a really big influence of where you place this, and that's overall part of how you decide to design something.
Yeah.
Knowing where the context is going to be, or whether it's going to be one of these roving things that could pop up. And if this is going to be at the airport, it might look very different than if you're going to take it to a festival that's very geared around people who might be volunteers in action engagement system. And so I think the evaluation at Centergy was a good attempt, the best attempt at what we could get, but really thinking next step of, given what you've designed, where might the best placement be for a true evaluation of it?
100%. As I agree with you 100%. As I was conducting that study, I was like, man, you would have just been really good pilots. And then I could have completely reworked this study. You know, done it in the morning. Placement is also like a design element that needs to be considered and tested for. There's so many variables outside the deliberate things that I put into the experiences that can be tested for as a part of this overall project that I just didn't have an end limit.
Why? So ultimately, your vision is to take the form factor of a kiosk or something?
No. I mean, its form factor was really just contingent on holding the necessary design elements that I selected. So there wasn't this kind of, there were so things like I mentioned, like I didn't really consider, I told, when I was doing the test, I told them, like, don't consider a vortices. I'm not testing for vortices right now. I'm only testing these four specific design elements. So the ultimate form factor was not something I was designing for. I was really designing to set a form factor, just a form factor to hold basically a box to hold all four of those design decisions.
You're making an assumption that it's physical environment as opposed to something that would exist
on your
laptop or something.
Well, the goal was, the initial research goal was physical interaction, and a physical interaction with the information.
Okay.
So I constrain myself to things that people touch in the real world off the visual environment. But my control was what is typically used in place of that. So that's why I chose my iPad.
I was just going to say, I appreciated how you set up in the beginning this task of trying to combine your research goals with this other goal of wanting to serve a nonprofit, and then we're pretty upfront about how challenging that is. And I think the one thing that would have really helped the presentation, and just something for you to think about going forward, would have been to have had a 30-second or 1 minute sort of video that really showed what that experience of interaction is like. Because we've all seen like a number of these sorts of things, and it looks like the form is quite compelling. But just a bit of feedback, like it's a little hard to grasp what that would be like, and if you present this again in the future, include some sort of video.
Right.
I think that would ground some of the discussion.
Yeah, absolutely. That makes sense.
Any other questions?
I will say I agree with that too. Like you can kind of skip to the end and say these are the two things, and then go into like how you got there instead of just going in entirely sequential order, and that'll kind of like paint a picture first that we can all. I mean, I have the benefit of knowing, but like kind of putting myself in someone's shoes that are seeing this for the first time, coming from the beginning instead of the end, and then what, but if you just show them the what first, and then tell the story behind it, it'll be a lot easier for the audience to connect dots.
Yeah, I'm hearing one of the audio stories from the
prototype.
Thanks, sir.
Thanks, sir.